How are you? How are you holding up during this time?
Yeah, good. How are you? We're
good.
You know, we're in there. Some days good, some days not so good. Just kind of depends.
Well, I've been really looking forward to this chat for a few reasons. I've been a big fan for a while, and so first new music in 5 years is really exciting. But I spent the weekend reading this.
Oh, wow, really?
And it is just, I just absolutely loved it. And so I've been really looking forward to doing this. And so
thank you for
spending the time with us today and doing this with us. Yeah. So really excited about the first new album in 5 years. It's called Hollywood Park. Do you want to talk about the book first or the album? Like, what makes the most sense to you?
This is your energy, bro. Go for it, whatever you like.
Well, because I know that the album's going to come out first, and then the book a few days later, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, because now I've read the book first and going to hear the album second, which is kind of interesting. So,
I think of it like, if I think of the project as sort of like the book is the, or rather the album's the soundtrack to the book. So it's sort of like if you see Purple Rain in the theater, then you go and you listen to Purple Rain. The soundtrack.
Yeah.
Something. I
don't know. Yeah. Well, and it's cool because after reading the book now, I went back and actually watched the trailer that you guys put out like a month ago. And it's so different now after you read the book. So
you're like, oh, that's why he's in prison. Oh, the A73. Oh, that's the prison. Oh, okay.
Give us a quick description of Hollywood Park, the book, your memoir.
It's a coming of age memoir about, I guess, giving voice to a child going through, let's say, some difficult circumstances, dealing with historical forces like war and incarceration and cult psychology, and then sort of coming to terms with who he invents to deal with that, and then as an adult, trying to uninvent the person he invented to deal with that.
It spans a lot of years for you, a lot of different things, and what was interesting to me about reading it as a fan is with all the stuff that you described that you went through as a child and all that, I was rooting for you the whole time, even though I knew like that you turned out to be the front man of Airborne Talks About. So when I turned to a chapter that then said Wishing Well, I got really excited. And does that make sense to you?
That's nice to hear. Yeah, I was trying to write the book without any particular idea in mind of it, you having to know me or know my story in any way. Like, I didn't expect that. And I was just kind of like the same reason you would read any memoir, just because, like, you didn't know who Mary Carr was, but you read Liar's Club because it's a good book, or you read, you know, This Boy's Life because it's a good memoir, you know, and you don't need to know who Tobias Wolff is. And so I was trying to, you know, write a piece of literature. I guess I would call it literary nonfiction, if I'm being fancy, that had resonance and had some real emotional, I like to think of it in terms of landscapes of the mind. Like, there's a lot of things in a book that, you know, I don't talk about, haven't talked about publicly. And, you know, it's sort of like, I don't mind meeting the reader, like on the windswept plane of page 200, you know, and having discussions about all this difficult stuff. Even though sort of like day to day, I haven't talked about it much. And certainly not, I think probably a lot of fans are like, no shit. but you know, we're not doing any particular thing as a band, so I just kind of felt like just tell my story and not worry about that sort of stuff.
You guys were kind of gone for 5 years. Is because you were working on this and writing it? Okay.
Yeah, the book took me 3 years to write and the record took 2 years to make. So I was in this room. This is my studio basement that I built. I built this little room down here. Oh, you're moving. Looks like you're in space. Oh, is someone moving a door? What is that?
Yeah, it was one of those, they open the door and see him doing something and then just awkwardly walk out.
It's just like the whole thing moved. It looked like something from Disneyland. Yeah, I spent about 3 years down here and just like, I was writing like 6 days a week, 12 hours a day, and really, really wanted to create this thing that was, you know, complex and layered and nuanced and honest and real. And it took a long time. Look, much longer than I thought it would. It was sort of like building the Watts Tower and towers in your basement. Like, imagine this like incredibly ornate thing that you then that no one's ever seen. You know, that there's this like crazy super, and the only person who'd ever seen it was like my wife. I talked to my wife about it, but literally, other than that, I didn't have an agent, I didn't have an editor, I didn't have a publisher, certainly, and I was just writing and trying to make this whole thing. And the book that you, the book that you hold up, that's not that different from what was on my Microsoft Word document. That was just kind of what it was. And I finished it before we went and tried to find me a literary agent or a publisher or any of that kind of stuff. So all the attention the book is getting has been like really weird because it's vulgar and it's sad. And yeah. I never expected my book to be, you know, gaining that kind of attention early on, because it's just a really vulgar and sad and sometimes tragic, you know. It's not bleak, I guess, but it's very sad at times, and I didn't expect that to be something that would be embraced so much. So it's been weird. This whole thing has been weird.
Well, I definitely cried a couple times. If I'm
being, where'd you cry? But it's
the very end when you're well, I don't want to spoil it.
Yeah, you don't want to give it away. Okay, that's just. I know what you're talking about.
Well, do you want to play a song and then we can dive a little bit into the album itself? I'm gonna scoot away.
How's that? Can you hear
because
me?
I don't want to be distracting with my face right here.
So this is a different version of the song. Come on out. Black lungs, headlights, heading off to the city tonight out the front door. Turn right, I was alone, alright. I wonder what you think of me. I'll run away, this is my town. I'm not heading off to the city tonight. And she said, come on out with it, come on out with it, come on out with it, come on out with it. Hard words on a hard night. I'll have a beer, won't you turn out the light from the front door? I could hear right, I'm just running, going. Wonder if I'll be turning back. I got 20 bucks in a pocket with my stash. I'm not afraid, I'm not sure. Good night. Just a shadow of a shadow tonight. And she said, come on out with it, come on out with it, come on out with it, come on out. And the night shadows watching, the darkness approaching. You came for life in the park. So you stand on the stage at such a young age, as you're feeling around in the dark. And your mother, she's calling, feel your hopes falling. There's nowhere to run to tonight. Just a fist on your face now, you hope to replace her. The emptiness fills you inside. Break my fall, please break my fall, break my fall, break my fall, please break my fall, break my fall.
Come on out with it.
Thank you so much for that. So that was the first song we heard from that album. And I remember reading the book very clearly, like the part where you put those words into it. The words come on out with it. Was there a specific reason or goal behind releasing that song first?
Oh, I just liked it.
Okay.
And the band liked it. It was sort of, not, I mean, there's no particular narrative. We just liked the song. And so every song on the record is from a different scene in the book. And that song's from the scene when I was 11 years old and I ran away from home. And, you know, my stepdad was, I don't know the polite way of saying it, he was a prick. And, you know, it's about, as much as anything, it's just about like the kind of dangerous world, the oddly dangerous world of children. I think as adults, we forget how dangerous the world of children can be and how complex our imaginations once were. I mean, they still are, but I'm saying that like also as children, you have really complex emotions and you have a big sort of inner world. And then but adults oftentimes just sort of think of the children as these little pliable little minds that are just, you know, not sort of tuned into these things. And yeah, so I was running away from home and I was angry about the circumstances and probably a little wounded and probably self-pitying, but at the same time, really righteous. I'm like, fuck these people, you know, kind of feeling it out. And, you know, the book tries to just give voice to that kid. You know, it was kind of an angry kid, at times angry, let's say. A lot of what the book is doing is just trying to, I don't know, give that kid a voice, because no one really asked us. We went through a lot of stuff and no one really asked us how it was affecting us. No one really said, like, so how was that? These really horrific things would happen, and then it was just like we were treated as accessories. And so the idea was to, you know, give it a voice.
I imagine this is the most open you've been about all that. But before this book, how open were you, like, about all that stuff?
Not very.
Not at all?
I think, I don't know what kind of childhood you had. But I think there's a tendency when you've had a traumatic one or elements of trauma, you can kind of respond one of two ways. And one is to become sort of like what my brother did, which he became a fucking like absolute rebel outlaw, you know, addict, and, you know, just was like, fuck the adults, fuck the world, fuck this. And then the other was, you know, you kind of become a super kid, you know, you become like, I can handle anything. And that was sort of what I did. So in a lot of ways, it's like you invent a person who can handle the things that you actually can't handle. And so I think that's what I did. And then, so I just kept playing that role for a lot of years. Maybe starting when I was 6 until I was probably, you know, in my 30s. And in some ways, becoming an artist was a type of unmasking. Because it was like, you know, in my day-to-day life, I was still very like, you know, my high school yearbook all says stuff like, remember me when you're president, you know, like everyone thought I was kind of going to politics or something. And then when I became an artist, it was like, no, fuck that. Fuck these people. I'm just too, I can't handle this. I can't handle this world. I you know, and then it became like, take these sort of broken things about my life and try to write songs about them and try to put it in my writing and try to put it into the band I created and stuff. And then, but you're still kind of like, then you're sort of, I don't know, fulfilling another role, I guess, if that makes any sense. And then the book is sort of like, okay, let's unmask the kid that had to create this man to handle these situations. I don't mean to get so esoteric, so early.
No, it's fine.
I feel like this level of sort of, you know, complexity should be way later in the interview.
No, it's fine.
Still be on the joke portion, the touring joke portion.
I spent the weekend reading it, and so it's cool to be able to talk to you about all of it. You know, it's not often you get to, after you spend an entire weekend reading a book, sit face to face with the author and talk about all of it. It's pretty wild. Do you want to play another song for us?
Yeah, I do. Hold on, I'm gonna do a little technical thing here.
Okay. Which is,
that was another example of stalling. You know all about that.
I do, yeah.
I don't know, something's going on. I must say something. Can't just have dead air.
Well, you're like flipping through papers and looking for something you're supposed to say. That's when you stall. Yeah.
Play all at once.
We were born without time, nameless in the arms of a mother, a father, and God. When the world waits for us, 1,000 years in the crush of our eyes, fearless and dark. And quietly we'd fade into sleep with nothing on our mind. Then we long to be loved in the rush we'd become something we thought we'd never be. We were surprised by how hard we left weary and scarred by the nights spent feeling incomplete. And all those evenings swearing at the sky, wishing for more time. All the promises we broke when we tried, they just wasted all our time. Get old all at once, and it comes like a punch in the gut, in the back, in the face. When it seems someone's lied, and our parents have died, so we hold on to each other in their place. And I feel the water rising around us. Maybe that's okay. Yeah, I feel the world changing all at once. I hope it'll be okay. And we all had one hope, there'd be someone looking down on the day we return our bodies to each other. And the ground.
Oh, thank you so much for that. Well, thank you so much for taking the time with us today.
All right, are we done? I was going to play some more music.
Oh, no, we're not done yet. Am I right in saying that the album release date and the book release date has changed a couple times?
Yeah, so...
is it because of all this?
Yeah, because of COVID, they thought we couldn't manufacture the book, and we thought it was going to be pushed for a long time, and then we got it. So I spent a weekend thinking, oh, man, the book's not even coming out. And then on Monday, they came in and said, your book was the last book to be printed at this factory before it shut down.
Oh, wow.
But if you bind it, which is this whole other thing, it's a separate, I don't know anything about this, but it's a separate thing. And they're like, and it's got it. We got to get there with a truck in like 2 hours. I was like, I'll go. I'll get two shady cousins. We'll fucking break in. We'll take the books. We'll put them on a pallet. We'll go to the, whatever you need. So literally, like by the skin of our teeth, the books got printed and sent to a protected bindery or whatever the book they're called, and so, but we, because of the extra travel and time and the binding schedule, we had to postpone the release by a couple weeks, but it was gonna be like a year.
Oh wow. Okay.
Yeah, so I was like, I was so depressed, I was so sad, man. I spent that weekend, I drank my weight in whiskey, It's just like, fuck, man, this sucks.
I know you had a book tour and all that kind of stuff planned. Yeah. Are you just going to keep doing stuff like this to try to keep the word out about it?
Yeah, well, so we didn't even cancel the book tour. We just moved it online. Okay. So everyone who bought tickets to the book tour, you get a proprietary code where it's just the people from who bought the tickets. And they're at the same time that they were before. And I'm doing, God, it must be like an hour and a half now of, I'm telling stories, and it's a whole thing. But it's stories from the book, stories from my life, and then singing songs and then answering questions of the people who bought tickets. And each event is still happening the night at the same time and sponsored by the local bookstore in the city it was originally sponsored by. And so, yeah, it's a whole thing. We're just trying to figure out how to way to, you know, still have it, not have the whole thing be, you know, shut down.
So we do have you at the Black Sheep here in Colorado Springs in October. Mm-hmm. All of that is still on.
It's still on, yeah.
Yeah, very excited about that. I've never seen you guys live, but I've been listening to you guys since.
We're okay.
So, a lot of people are requesting Graveyard in the chat.
Oh yeah.
Any?
All right, I'll play Graveyard if you guys
do that.
The other winter when we were walking by the graveyard near the house, you asked me if I thought we would ever die. And if life and love both fade so predictably, we made ourselves a kind of predictable life. And so I pictured us like corpses lying side by side in pieces in some dark and lonely plot under a bough. We look so silly there, all decomposed, half turned to dust in tattered clothes, and we probably look just as silly now. Bye 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 to all this dogged innocence. I can't pretend that I can tell you what is going to happen next or how to be. But you have no idea about me, do you? So it left me to wonder if people ever know each other. They just stumble around like strangers in the dark. But sometimes you seem so strange to me, I must seem strange to you, but like to actors playing our parts. Did you memorize your lines? Cause I did. Here's the part where I get so mad, I tell you that I can't forget your past. And you get so quiet now, and you seem somehow like a lost and lonely child, and you just hope that this moment won't. Bye 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 to all this dog-eared innocence. I can't pretend that I could tell you what is going to happen next or how to be. But you have no idea about me. You have no idea about me. So there's always a way around. There's something tying all our feet to the ground. The moment passed, we hear how it sounds. And it seems a little less profound. Like we're all going the same way down. Cause we're all going the same way down. And I'm just trying to write it all down. Cause I write songs and you write letters. We are tied like two antennas. And we talk and we eat and we laugh and sleep and lay in bed together. And you wake in tears sometimes. I can see the thoughts flash across your eyes and say, darling, will you be kind? Will you be a good man? Will you stay behind if I get old?
So the letters all danced through my head with the words that I was told. About the fading flesh of life and love, the failures of the bold. And I can list each crippling fear like I'm reading from a well. And I'll defy everyone and love you still. I will carry you with me up every hill. And if you die before I die, I'll carve your name out of the sky. And I'll fall asleep with your memory, and I'll dream of where you lie. Some say it's better to move on and to let life just carry on, and I may be wrong. Still I'll try, 'cause it's better to love whether you win or lose or die. It's better to love whether you win or lose or die. It's better to love, and I will love you till I die.
During this time, I've been talking to a lot of bands and asking what they're doing to stay busy right now. And a lot of them are saying they're writing new music and just staying busy that way. But since you just like wrote a bunch of new music, are you doing the same, or how are you keeping busy right now?
Oh man, I'm working 12-hour days right now. There's a lot that goes into putting a book out and a lot that goes into putting a record out. And so we're doing both at the same time in the middle of a pandemic. It's like there's a lot to do. So it's nice though. It feels like a blessing to have a purpose right now. You know, I feel bad for people who lost their jobs, and you know, I feel kind of like, particularly, you know, the people hit hardest are the people who are, you know, dead obviously and dying, and the people who love them. And after that, it's, you know, people who've just gotten very, very sick. And after that, it's frontline workers. You know, it's nurses and doctors and janitors and, you know, a lot of people working at grocery stores and in service industries that are, you know, making sure the rest of us are staying, you know, sane and able to eat. And I'm just very appreciative for what all they're doing. And so for me, I feel lucky. I get to continue to have my career. And the only difference really is I've never been one for this kind of thing. I've always kind of sort of notoriously not done anything like this.
Yeah.
And I just felt like, and I think fans do know that. They're like, holy shit, why are you doing all these things? And it's because I kind of like meeting people at the show, or I like being able to control the, you know, if it's a video, let's have it look a certain way. And then in this, but during this time, it felt important to, you know, stay connected. And, you know, so I've been making a lot of videos and doing a lot of online stuff. I'm not one for the online part. I feel like online, like, I'm on Twitter, but that's mostly just to talk about what an asshole Trump is. Try to have some sort of the voice of sanity and frustration or something. I don't know.
Yeah, it's a good vehicle for it.
I think Twitter is best understood that way. It's just Twitter's it's a marketplace of ideas. And it's like, every time you get a retweet or a like, it's like someone's buying. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, have I got some sarcasm for you? You know, or here's some fucking, you know, stats, or here's a story. And I try to approach it like a journalist would, where if it's, you know, I vet everything, and if it's wrong, I pull it and let people know, and you know, try to be responsible about, you know, what information I'm passing on. But then also just trying to be authentic, trying to be honest about what it's like for me, just, or what I think feels like a moment in history that it's important to speak up, no matter who you are.
Mm-hmm.
About what's happening and the really wrong fucking things that are happening.
Well, I've seen a lot of people in here, how appreciative they are for you doing this kind of stuff. It feels weird, you know, I'm in here by myself. I imagine you're probably in that room by yourself. Yeah. And so it feels kind of odd. Mm-hmm. But I've seen a lot of people put in the chat, mm-hmm, how appreciative they are of these live streams and you still connecting with them. So that's any consolation.
No, I'm happy to do it. Like most songwriters, you just write songs on the edge of your bed anyway. So this is kind of the same way I write songs, just sitting in a room with a guitar. So it's not hard. You know, like, oh, we'll play that song. Okay.
Well, do you want to do one more for us? Do you want to do Fall of Rome? Is that what you said you want to do? Or?
That's too, like, sad to go out on.
All right.
Let's do Let's do a little medley here.
You totally ignoring me, she said, as she put on a shirt. I was lying on the bed, concentrating on a skirt. I didn't hear one word I said, she said, I don't know, it's all a blur. I closed my eyes. And you fell in love in a great big rush for years ago. June, I do recall playing arcade games with her and wanting nothing at all. This silly skinny girl intended to trip and fall on the rides. But then summer came and we felt the strain of the damning things we said. All the summer rains were like hurricanes as they flew around our heads. So many endless conversations, you know, things you could have done alone. Instead. So I fucked it up like I always do. I was born to be alone. I don't even know if the words were true when I screamed into the phone. All I know is everybody leaves, or so it seems to me when I'm alone, 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 alone. But I was younger and then stronger, and somehow I can't explain how the years can be so humbling, so strangely full of pain. Just how everyone and everything must changing, 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 changing. And sometimes it seems like everything I do is a fucking waste. In fact, that's it. I think, well, maybe I'm sure. But I'm trying every morning that I wake to stand up straight, to always tell the truth, to give back more than I take, and to be kind and pure. That's fucking scared of everything. I just can't take much more of this, I'm sure. Hey, little girl, is your daddy home? Did he go and leave you all alone? I got a bad desire. Tell me now, baby, is he good to you? And does he do to you the things I never do? Cause I can take you high. Ooh, I'm on fire. Sometimes it's like someone took a knife, maybe edgy and dull, and cut a 6-inch valley through the middle of my skull. Nights I wake up with my seat soaking wet and a freight train running through the middle of my head. The cool mind is out. No, I'm on fire. No, I'm on fire. No, I'm on fire. Thank you. train keeps moving on down the San Antonio. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't you ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry. There's probably rich girls sitting in some fancy dining car. They're probably sipping coffee and they're smoking those big cigars. But I know I had it coming. I know I can't be free. But those people keep moving. And that's what tortures me.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to do this. Any advice before I let you go for anybody out there that might be struggling right now, like mentally or with everything going on?
If you're feeling depressed, just be depressed. It's okay to be depressed. Like if you're like, I feel like there's so much like, here are some great ways to get through the day. You know what? Go cry. Go be sad. And then start to let yourself feel okay. But the way forward is through it. It's not around it. It's not by denying it and all that kind of stuff. It's a depressing time. It sucks. Yeah. Everyone's struggling. You're struggling. I'm struggling. A lot of people are really dealing with tragedy and also just minor tragedies, things that you feel like you can't complain about. Your feelings are valid. Just because people are dying doesn't mean it doesn't suck that you can't see your boyfriend, or doesn't suck that you can't finish that project, or that you can't go to work, or that you can't see your friends, or that you're feeling like you're isolated and alone. All these things are valid and they're real. And just know it, own it, understand that we're all kind of there with you, and know that you have friends in the world, people who want to see you, and there's beautiful things in the future. And right now it just fucking sucks, and just let it suck. That's the best advice I can give.
Yeah, there is a slight comfort in knowing that we're all in this together. So I try to remember that all the time, you know?
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much again for doing this. So the album is out May 22nd, and then the book is out May 26th. Am I right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much for taking the time and having me. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. Thank you.
I'll see you down the road.
Talk to you later.
Bye-bye.